Hey, you guys.
Happy Wednesday.
Yeah, happy Wednesday. Happy hump day. Let me dial some of this. I'm just settling into my comfortable little place. I'll tell you what, it has really been a lot of fun doing the show. And this is really, I've lived my life on a stage, but this is a much different, it's a much different platform. And just like anything, any stage that I've ever been on,
there's an asshole next to you.
Wow. I don't even know how to respond to that.
Well, I just couldn't, you know, at my expense.
Wow.
I couldn't let it go by.
You know who you're talking to? I just have learned to keep my mouth shut and don't say those things. But hey, you know what? It's the US Open. Go for it.
Right, but I see an opportunity.
Yeah.
Even at my own expense.
Nice passing. Was that your... Well, yeah, but you know, that was sort of, you took yourself down in order to take like five other people down at the same time.
Only
well,
listen,
do we want to count? Oh, man, wait a minute. All right, let's count. Let's count.
No.
No, come on, hang on.
Count the assholes?
All right. We're...
Oh, okay.
I'm, you know what? You're the asshole in somebody's story.
That's right.
You are you.
I know I am.
I am. And so are you. I'm telling it. Okay, so we're off to a good start here.
Yes.
This is going to be interesting. Rick Emmett, Triumph, huge Canadian successful band. I certainly know their hits. I don't know much of their history or so on and so forth. I do know that I think Rick released more solo albums than they released Triumph albums.
He is a jazz player.
He's got an eclectic musical style. It's all, you know, it's, which is, you know me, guys. I mean, I'm everything from Sarah Smile to Birds of Fire. So, you know, my playlist. But, and so this will be very interesting because now, and watch this, kids. Tell me I don't have it together. He's got a book of poetry, which I have mine right here, and I've marked a couple of places in it. And I got an advanced reading copy for promotional use, which is very cool. You know, I like that kind of stuff. So, and there's some, I read as much as I could in the time I had to go through. I'm not freaking Oprah, but.
It took us like 3 months to read the book, and we were in it.
Did it take 3 months? It didn't take three months.
We would read a chapter a day. Yeah,
we were going to wait for the movie to come out, but I was afraid I wouldn't be in the movie, so we read the book.
It's kind of like, song lyrics, they're poems.
Well, yeah, but there's some, I'm going to talk to him, we'll talk about it. I got to ask some questions. Don't ruin the surprise. I was just looking at it for the pictures. which is interesting because I think art is in his quiver of things to do. So it'd be interesting to know.
Yes. Cartoon art.
Is it cartoon art?
Yeah.
Like John's cartoon art?
No, well.
Oh, no, character art, not people, yes. Not caricatures.
Yeah, musician satire art for some magazine or something.
Right. Like an R. Crumb type of deal.
Yeah.
Yeah, like you know what R. Crumb is.
No. But.
Well, you gonna look it up?
You don't know. R. Crumb? I don't know what Rick's.
What?
I can't compare it to Rick's because I've never seen Rick's.
No. R. Crumb. All right. Listen.
Is R. Crumb a mouse or?
No, R. Crumb is the guy who. Look it up.
Just the it was a bad R? Word.
What?
The initial R?
Yeah, R C R U M B, I think, or C R U M M. It's weird.
His first name is R.
He's an author.
Okay. Who knew you were so schooled? That's like pornographic.
That's not pornographic. Well, a little. That's but, not that. No, but I never saw that.
Uh-huh. What about that one?
Oh. Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying.
What do happy chicks do when they do their thing?
I'm sorry I even brought it up. My mind is so shorted out now. I can't even remember how we got here. How about we go over to Ed Roth, Big Daddy Ed Roth, Rat Fink?
No. How about we don't?
All right, you stuck on R. Crumb?
No, I'm getting off of R. Crumb.
It's on your computer now. You're getting off on R. Crumb? Okay.
I'm leaving now.
Is it time for a video? I think
yes, it is.
Check it out, kids.
Okay.
To be free, she gets the magic power.
Yeah, man. Cool.
Wow, that's very cool. Do that.
Hey.
Hey.
How are you?
I'm okay. I, you know, suffering from having to watch myself, you know, as a young man doing crazy things.
Oh, you sounded great.
Yeah, first of all, it was a great performance. And second of all, what makes you think you're not still a young man doing crazy things?
I'm still a young man.
Baby. And I'm doing crazy things. Yeah. Listen, I know... I consider myself to be a professional child. So, you know, that's, So listen.
Well, was it Brian Adams that said there's like large parts of me that are still 17 or something? Always forever 17, that kind of thing.
Yep. So I guess 17 was a good time. I'll stick with 17. That was a good, good year.
Yeah. Okay. That was 83. I would have been 30 years old.
I would have been 31. So yeah. There we go.
Were you in that crowd?
In that crowd? No.
That was LA, right?
No, where was that?
That was, sort of north of LA. Yeah, like San Bernardino or, you know, I can't remember exactly where it was, but, you know, outside of LA in the hills, in the mountains, kind of.
That wasn't the US Festival, though, no?
That was.
Oh, it was?
Yeah.
Okay.
May 29, 1983. Like 250,000 people or something, and then they were all very stoned. Most of them were very, very high.
Well, I understand that there was a mandate back then when you could do that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Stoned mandate.
It was in San Bernardino.
Yeah, it was in San Bernardino.
That was it. What did I say?
I'll tell you an interesting, you know, first of all, welcome to my party. I'm just up here floating in space.
Thank you.
And
you would have been in New York in 83.
I would have been, yeah.
Yeah. So you weren't in LA.
No.
I wanted to know if you were in the crowd there.
No, and I said no. I was just I was going with our ages. It was my way of subtling dropping in that we're in the same age bracket.
Gotcha.
Guess who that is? That's my wife. Lori.
Yeah.
Hello, Mrs. Luongo.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. She's
Luongo.
She you know what? There's two ways of saying it. Right? If we're in Italy and I'm doing my fashion line, it's Luongo.
Yes.
But if I'm in New York and I'm playing drums, it's Luongo.
Yeah. In Canada, there's a chain of food stores, like grocery stores, that are called Luongo. And it's pretty famous, pretty large, you know, big money, like they're a rich family, but Luongo's have been around for a long, long time. Yeah.
Spelled that way with the U?
Yeah.
Because
like,
you're related to all of Luongo.
Yeah, because, well, I don't know if I can get here on my phone quick enough, but I'll make you laugh since you brought it up. Because, oh, here you go. It's my, I don't know if you could see that. That's my family.
A little to your left.
Oh, yeah.
Not your left. Yeah, that's the other
left.
Getting a reflection from your lights. Yeah. Is that your family in Italy?
Yeah, no, that's while they're here. That's my dad in the middle laughing with the, you know, with the, it's, and my cousins.
Grandparents were from Italy.
Yeah, my grandparents immigrated from Italy. Mike, the original Mike. Anyway, yeah, it's a
cool.
It's that. Yeah, I got to go up and get my cut, right?
Your Canadian cousins.
Yeah, my Canadian cousins.
That's right.
So, all right. So now that we've totally gone off the rails, interesting because I got the book and I read some of the stuff and it's, at first glance, it's lyrical, but it's pretty deep. I didn't get through a lot of passages, but I got to two that I just flipping to read and Ticket to Ride. And what was the second? There's actually a bunch of them. Oh, look. Okay. Oh, yeah. My dog has joined us in the capsule. Pleasantly enough, he's wet. So let's, you know, party at my house.
It's nice when they smell that way, especially in a small space capsule. You know, wet dog is a good smell to have.
Yeah, yeah.
But he just had a bath the other day, so.
Yeah.
He's still wet?
He goes in the pool every
Every time you... He's a swimmer.
Phelps. We call him Michael Phelps.
Yeah. And, you know, that's good for him, you know. It's
We've had a few of those kind of dogs in our life. The one I have now, she's deadly afraid of the water, which is too bad because she's got a little bit of poodle in her. Usually poodles are, you know, they're pretty good with water, but no, she's scared out of her mind.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Does
well,
she
he's
a golden doodle?
Come here. Come on up here.
The one that I got is it's a cross between an Australian Shepherd and a poodle.
Oh, let me see if I can get this monster up here.
There he is. Look at that.
There he is.
Is it a guy or a girl?
He's a boy. Remy.
Remy. And he sings.
Yeah, he sings.
In the jungle.
Thank you.
That's your time.
Okay,
you
that's it.
Any more time.
All right. Very good.
Yeah. It runs in the family.
The lion's not sleeping after all of that for soprano dog stuff.
So, man, I'll tell you what, when I decided to do this show, you know, and everybody locked down. And it's funny because according to whatever information I got, you kind of decided what, 2017, 18, you were going to pull it back a little bit.
Yeah.
I did the same thing.
Yeah.
My timing has been, you know, kind of immaculate during this whole thing. Like I had decided to retire from teaching at the college in the fall of sort of 2018. And then I was still touring. Had my American visa as I had every year of my life since whenever. And then I played my last gig in the States in December of 2018, the last Canadian gig, January of 2019. And I said, okay, I'm gonna take a hiatus now and I'm gonna see what it's like to have a life where, you know, you're not gearing up to go out on the road every weekend. And And I started doing a lot of writing and then COVID came along. And so then I was doing a lot of writing because what else was there to do? One thing led to another. I'd always sort of felt like I had a book of poetry in me. And of course, so much of my writing through the course of my life had always sort of, you know, veered towards, even if I had poetic ideas, they went towards lyrics. You know,
pentameter wise, how they laid out as lyrics?
Well, yeah, like phrasing is, but see the thing, one of the big differences between writing lyrics and writing poetry is, and I discovered this going through the process, not like I wasn't, you know, kind of intuitively aware of it before, but when you write lyrics, there's a form is really, it's a disciplined kind of thing. You come up with a chunk of something like a verse. Well, now you got to get other verses to match. You come up with a chorus, the other choruses are going to be the same, et cetera, et cetera. Whereas with poetry, you know, they kind of take the shackles off you and you can be a little bit more, and not just form, you can also, your ideas can kind of be a little more elliptical and a little bit more, the metaphors can stretch further. Because when it's just words on a page, I think you can ask more of a reader and you can ask more of yourself than if you're just using a popular song. A popular song, you kind of have to structure it so that people hear it for the first time and go, I get that. But a poem, you can go like, people read it and they go, what the hell is he driving at? And then they read it again, they go, ooh, I think I got a clue from this. Well, why did he choose this word for that phrase? And then people start going, I think I get this, you know, and maybe by the fourth or fifth read, they're going, oh man, yeah, this is like, I really like what this guy did. Now, not everybody's going to stay with you through four or five reads, you know, but that's the difference, you know, that's one of the big differences between the forms.
Well, I wouldn't say I've written poetry, but I've certainly written my share of lyrics, and I get it from that point. And I mean, I remember, you know, when you had a choice of what classes you know, I took as much English and any of that kind of stuff as I could get to, for that reason, because I wanted to, you know, I wanted to be a composer, I wanted to be a lyricist, and you know, that's so I get it. But now I touched on two pieces in here, okay? And let me
did you hold the book up?
What, of course I did. Of course I did. But I have a, you know, I have
I can do that. What is your wife's first name?
I've got you covered. Okay. No, there's no work for you here. You just sit back and enjoy the rest.
Oh, see? Look at that.
Right?
Ah, beautiful.
I mean, really.
Very nice. Yeah.
Oh, and I have mine, but that's, yeah, that's it. And it's interesting. Like I said, I landed on Ticket to Ride. Well, of course, I would be engaged by that, given our time on Earth. You know, I remember life before the Beatles. So yeah, that intrigued me. And then Look, I think, is the other one.
Uh-huh. I don't remember Look. I'll have to look it up.
Look, up in the sky, the carbon and methane vultures are circling.
Yeah.
Harbingers of suffocation. Look down. The cockroaches are inheriting the earth. Yeah. That's Look.
Wow.
Yeah.
Look, over there in the parking lot, dogs are eating dogs. Look around us. The walls are closing in. Look back there. The past is gaining on you.
Wow.
Yeah.
I get that.
Yeah, well, anyway, I don't want to spoil the ending.
You know, Steve, the ending is the same for all of us.
Well, I know. I know that. Now, I mean, and we can go there, man. I mean, do you think that it is a definitive end, or do you think it's a transition and everything is connected?
No, I do think on a certain level that all things are connected, but I think carbon-based life forms, and I think somewhere in the book it says this. You know, we are, the only thing that makes sense to me is that when we lose our senses, which is to say our brains are not working anymore, we're gone. Whoever we are, it's gone. And, you know, I think the poetry, well, first of all, let me say this. I think the poems and poets exist partly because what they're trying to deal with is our mortality. That's one of the big reasons that poets write poetry, because they're just trying to figure this out. This, because a lot of it does not make sense. A lot of it is random chaos. And just to extrapolate on this, you know, you've had people storm the Capitol. Here in Canada, we've got an election coming up, and people were pelting the prime minister with gravel the other day, like picking up stones and whipping them at the prime minister. And you just kind of go, okay, how can people be so brutally stupid that they could do this? And I love people. I look at me on stage there playing to those hundreds of thousands of people. Like, I want to believe the best of people, but people keep disappointing me in horrible, terrible ways. And I think that's another reason why poets write. So back to Look, you know, here we are on a planet where the planet is starting to go, you human beings, what are you doing to me? You know, I'm going to visit an awful lot of horrible stuff on you. So you wake up and realize that you only have a finite period of time here to try and do good. Don't put all this junk into the air, and don't eat up all my resources, and don't kill the animals that exist. Anyway, so a lot of my poetry came from that, my swinging from how much I love people to how much I'm becoming misanthropic, you know?
Well, first of all, I mean, we live in a divided world. I don't go into the politics thing. We have the no gloom gong and that whole thing, because this is supposed to be the no gloom ballroom. But people, it's, first of all, I'll tell you this. One of the things, and I labor over this a great deal because of the things that I read, and you know, I started other ones, but those are the ones that I really absorbed. you know, there's darkness in there, and with good reason. I mean, I get that. But there's a thing that I believe, that I truly believe in my mind. I read a book called The Untethered Soul by Michael Singer. You know that book? Okay, there you go. Yeah. So
I am
the one who sees. I believe that this thing, the carbon suit that you're talking about, and this dimensional reality, yeah, that's, you know, how long can you stay on the roller coaster? But I believe there's a whole nother park out there with different rides, and that's where I'm going. So I'm not afraid of it. And I also realize that the only moment that really matters in the name of Ram Dass is now, be here now, right? So now, you know, now none of those maniacs are trying to break down into my house. Nobody has taken away any of my liberties or freedoms or any of that stuff. I am safe. I am calm for now. And, you know, I think it is all connected. I think, you know, I'm not that I'm in a hurry, but I'm looking forward to whatever comes next.
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, and I don't disagree with that Zen Buddhist kind of, you know, being in the now, feeling the flow of things, feeling the connection of things. Zen Buddhism doesn't necessarily, in many of its forms, they don't have an afterlife. There's really just the life that they can, you know, perceive as flowing through the now. But to address some of the other things you raised, I mean, one of the first things that I ever read that really made me go, oh, this makes sense to me, was Bertrand Russell. And he's, you know, that was the birth of sort of agnosticism in a humanitarianism in a very strong way. And that made sense to me more than the idea of a kind of a cosmic afterlife or even the idea of, oh, in this life, I'm gonna try and attach my behavior and the things that I do towards earning the ticket to the afterlife. This is a big thing that I think it destroys a lot of human potential, that they spend so much time and energy chasing something that's, you're not even sure that's gonna happen. And I tend to be a little bit more agnostic about that and go, look, sorry, I'm not buying that. What are we going to do now to make now good? Let's make now good. Let's not worry about where we're going to be after we die, because
that's the last thing I'm worried about. Believe me, and I'll tell you what, I had a near death experience. How long ago? 37 years ago.
In 84.
Right. Yeah, 84. Some idiot dropped a 22-pound metal plate off of a bridge. It came through a car that I was driving in at the time. And it, you know, But I also was told another thing. Until it's your time, you're invulnerable. So, I mean, yeah, you can go the whole Zen way. But when this thing happened to me, and I'm not telling you what it was because I don't know what it was, but I was somewhere, and I've heard other people talk about near-death experiences or after, and believe me, I'm not one of those guys that has 20 ghost stories, but it was incredibly peaceful. There were colors without light is the only way I can explain it, but I couldn't really see anything. However, I felt like there was a low ceiling and the expanse went on like a bowling alley, you know, it's low and right. And then I remember being sucked out of that like a vacuum and trying not to be taken out of it and coming back out of it. And all of a sudden it was broken windshield and bloody girl. And it was, you know,
not me.
Not you. No.
And Bruce,
no, that would have been bloody girl. Heart,
punctured lungs, six.
Yeah, it was. But we don't want to go there. It's just, I don't know.
Yeah, for a no gloom capsule, buddy.
Here, you know what? This.
Okay, you can keep going.
There we go. The no gloom button. Yeah. Right. Well, I'm glad you recovered fully and made it to your space capsule. You know.
I did.
Yeah. I. Well, people are just going to have to get my book and read it, and then they're going to get a sense of the wide range of the fact that, you know, I'm dancing around it in a thousand ways, you know. So
it's on Amazon, right?
Yeah, yeah.
How do they get it?
By ECW Press, you know, and
we'll post all this on the site, by the way, for people that are interested. And if you're a fan of poetry, or maybe even if you're not a fan of poetry, I'm looking forward more and more to reading this, because it's words are powerful. And I think
there's a lot of levels that it works on. I mean, it was autobiographical, a great deal of it. Ticket to Ride, for example, was really about the fact that my dad was
getting old
and had dementia, and you know, there was taking care of him, and he's since passed away. And you know, I've written Ticket to Ride PS, like, you know, now that he's gone, you know, how do I see things now? That autobiographical thing is part of it. But another thing too was that, you know, my son had said to me at one point, sitting at the dining room, the kitchen table, "Oh, Dad, you should write a book, because you always want to talk about politics and religion and all the things you're not supposed to talk about. You should write a book." And so the book is divided into sections that sort of, one of them's kind of political, one of them's about religion, one of them's about being a rock star and the life that I've had, you know, and how I had to keep reinventing myself over the course of it, you know, which we all have to do. Yeah.
No, that's, I was going to say, that's the trick. That's really the trick. I mean, I don't know how many guys, you know, we're all lifers. We'll all be this. This is what we are. This is what we do. And if you truly are, you know, a lifetime member of our club, you have to figure it out. It's not like, oh, well, I didn't make it. I guess what now? Donuts? I don't, you know, it's cars. I'm not, you know, what comes next? It's, you have to, at least in my case, I have to be in this business. When the reason that I backed off from touring, I had done a reunion with a band that I was with for 25 years. And you know, this is going back to 2017, December. And then, the following year, I think I was still touring with Robin Zander from Cheap Trick. Mm-hmm. And then 17. It was after Zander was 16. I was developing a fashion line based on my original art, because I've always been an artist, like forever, even before music. I was scribbling and things. And so all of those things that we did for enjoyment have been recycled into our lives as, you know, points on our resume, I guess.
Yes. And you know, to me, it's just about creativity. For you know, like, I might have retired from the road, but I certainly haven't retired from playing guitar. You know, that is like lifeblood to me. You know, I have to do that. I would lose my mind if I couldn't, I think. But also writing songs, and then now writing poetry. And I wrote for Guitar Player Magazine. I'm a prolific email writer. I have a members forum on my website, and I answer folks their email there all the time. Like, I just like to communicate, you know, on different levels. And I've always been able to earn a living from it, you know, so.
Yeah, well, that's kind of the blessing in the whole thing, or the, you know, the good luck in the whole thing, is that to do what you love, if that's a, you know, when you have to do something to survive, to pay the mortgage or pay the car or whatever it is, it's a lot different than if you have to do something because you're compelled internally to do it. That way, then the money doesn't even matter. Of course, it matters in the real world. But I've seen more guys go broke, willingly go broke, pursuing that inner need than I have, you know, leave the business at 30 and do something else that was successful. You know, it's a weird issue of that guy.
Yeah. And I think part of it, too, is the your own definition of success, right? Like, what is actually making you happy? What is actually making you feel fulfilled? And you're talking about, you're hearing the voice calling to you. You know, the work calls you. And when I taught at the college, and, you know, some people might look at that and say, oh, you know, he was becoming a teacher. Why wasn't he, you know, putting on spandex pants and jumping around on stage? But the thing was that I loved that. I loved being around young musicians who still had idealism and who were going to kick my ass about things that I might not listen to or get around to. And I was on a faculty with unbelievably great jazz musicians and stuff. So there was a community there that I really loved being a part of. But that called to me, that spoke to me. And I would say to those students, look, when you're writing something, and when you're composing a piece of music, at a certain point, if you're getting good at what you're doing, then that work is going to start talking to you and telling you what it wants to become. Your ego gets out of the way, and the work starts to tell you what it wants to be and what it wants to do. And that's when you're on the right path, because you're being called. And as opposed to vocation, it's avocation. You're being called, you know.
So. Well, yeah, it's you're compelled to do. I'm compelled to do it. I said, Sam, you know, and I've told this story way too many times, but I announced to a kid in school that I was going to play drums for the rest of my life after hearing the high school band do an assembly in my auditorium as a kindergartner or whatever. Yep. And I mean, how do I even know what that is? I don't know.
Have you seen that thing? It's on Netflix called Count Me In.
Yes, I just watched it the other day.
Unreal, eh? Wasn't it great?
Yeah, I think it's greater for not drummers than it is for drummers.
Yeah.
Because,
explain.
Because it's, there's so much to playing drums. I enjoyed Cindy Blackman. I enjoy her groove, but I didn't think that they got into the nuance of because I am a drummer, you know what I mean? I think it was made for people that want to get one step closer to my instrument. Do you play drums at all?
No, not really. I mean, you know, what I've had the great distinct pleasure of doing is playing with great drummers. Randy Cook played with me. Paul DeLong played in my band. And the thing about the movie was I got to see Chad Smith, and I produced a band that Chad was in. They were out of Detroit. They were called Purple Gang. And I did sessions with them, and I called him my wood chopper. The guy, when he would play, the floor would be just, you know, filled with slivers of sticks, and he would be going through them like crazy. And he was the best thing about that band by far, you know. And the second I saw him playing, I went, oh, this guy's destined for wherever he lands. He's going to make the band better, you know.
I'm not by any means taking anything away from the artists in the film. I mean, they're what's her name?
I didn't know the guy that was. Who was the guy that was like with the shorter hair? That was, he was kind of the star of the thing.
He played with Pyro.
Porno for Pyros.
Porno for Pyros, and the he was a very infectious kind of guy. Like, I liked his energy, but of course that's drummers for me. I think.
Well, I was just gonna say we are what I mean. That's what we are. You know what I mean? And it's funny. The longer I've done the show, the more I realize how. I don't even know if it's idiosyncratic. We are so, I don't know, something in your DNA that makes you want to hit something with a stick. I don't know.
I've lived with them all my life, so I know drummers. You know, I'm going to tell you a great story because I love this story. Do you know who the guitar player Kim Mitchell is?
Yes.
Canadian guy. So Kim and I are doing a double bill, and it was in upstate New York somewhere. And it was in one of those places where the stage is in the middle of a dirt track, because they would do horse and buggy races, or, you know, like that kind of thing, horse races.
Yeah,
so it's a big dirt track. And so the stage is such, from the dressing rooms, they give you golf carts kind of to be able to get out to the stage and go back to the dressing rooms. So we're doing sound check, and it's a hot summer afternoon. And at one point we hear this whooping and screaming, and Kim and I are standing together, and we turn and we look, and his drummer and my drummer, and both guys had played in my band for a while, Greg Critchley and Randy Cook, and they both played in his band. So they're out, and they've stolen one of the golf carts, and they're out and they're driving on the track, and there's a giant plume of dust and dirt coming up from behind, and they're just whooping and screaming, and it's like they're having the time of their lives with this stolen vehicle. And Kim is a big, tall stork of a guy, you know, and he turns and he looks at shrimpy little me, and he just goes, fucking drummers, eh? Which was so Canadian. He goes,
yeah, but
fucking drummers, eh?
You know what? I have a, I like to stay with the theme.
Okay. So crazy drummers? Is that
our new theme? Well, it gets better than that. Drummers, Canada, weed, okay?
Okay.
I'm touring with John Entwistle, and we enter Canada on the west side, and we're doing every province, all the whole thing. We're all the way across, and, you know, back in that time, I was a regular member of the Olympic pot-smoking team, trained by Rastas themselves.
All right, very good.
So on our way through Canada, I don't know anybody up there. You don't bring anything there. You don't do that. And so now all of a sudden I'm like twitching, right?
Right.
So we get to the East Coast. I don't know where, past Manitoba, wherever. We're almost to Toronto. And my tour manager comes up to me and he puts something in my hand. And it's a plastic bag, and I can feel that there's organic. So, you know, I'm hoping it's not mushrooms or something to eat. And I said, oh, Billy, man, thank you. So this is great. And I went back to my room, smoked a joint. It was some hydroponic madness that you guys grow up there. Yeah. And I got so ripped.
This was in the
90s. I've never been that paranoid in my entire life. I hid the shit in like five different places in my room. I got down into the car with everybody to go to the club. I'm paranoid because there's like $30,000 or $40,000 in cash in the hotel safe. And I'm thinking they're going to smell the pot. They're going to bust my room. They're going to take the money. And I mean, I'm going, so I left and went back, and the next day, I didn't want to just flush it down the toilet because it was incredible.
Because you're coming back to
Because I'm coming back to New York now.
Yeah.
And now it's got to go. And I see this van, like a U-Haul looking van,
or
Ford Econoline, and it had drums and congas and maracas painted all over it, and it said "Drum for Life." And I said, "These guys will know what to do with this." And I walked over there. They could see the tour bus, so they knew that it wasn't the FBI. And I said, "Listen, guys, I'm leaving town. I don't want to waste any of this. You don't have to look at it. I'm just going to drop it in your van, and you can either kick it out and drive away or whatever." And man, they took it. Yeah,
good story.
Man.
Yeah, it's legal here now, you know, Steve.
Yeah.
Well, you can get it anyway. We have government stores that sell it. And in fact, here's a little story. My wife the other day, she's cooking dinner, and she comes to me, and she sits down in a chair in the living room and says to me, "Rick, you're going to have to finish making dinner. Turn the barbecue off and do the stuff. I'm kind of a little too high right now." I go, what?
I love her.
Well, she bought this stuff, and she'd only had a couple of tokes of this stuff, but it was, she said, everything turned purple and pink. And I go, "Purple haze." And she goes, I think I had a purple haze moment. Yeah.
She was in the purple gang.
Yeah.
Well, the whole rhythm section was the purple gang.
He's been married
Do you know what that is? Do you know who the purple gang was?
Absolutely, I do. From Jailhouse Rock.
Bad Boys, yeah, but they were actually a gang in Detroit.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, and that's why the band called themselves that, because they were from Detroit, so they called themselves the Purple Gang.
Hey, listen, I love, you know, some of those just historic threads. And in fact, next week I'm having a guy on who is analyzing the hidden mysteries and secrets to imagery and rock and roll and in jewelry.
He's a
symbologist, which I would have thought was somebody who studied symbols, but it's the study of, you know, the symbolism of things.
Yeah.
But I have another video, and this is juxtaposed to the first one that I played. I'm guessing this was not recorded far from where you're sitting now. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Which one are you going to play? Because there's two new ones.
I think this is one of them also in the book.
Yeah, both of them are. But because here's the
make
thing.
It hard sometimes on you.
Sometimes you're writing a poem and the poem goes, "I'm sorry, Rick. I want to be a lyric. You must turn me into a lyric. I want to be a lyric." And I go, okay, I'm not going to fight it. So there's two. Born to Pay is a song about sort of getting old and having your youth chasing you. And I had another one called World of Song, but I don't think that video comes out till next week. So you're probably going to play Born to Pay.
Well, and there's a turquoise twin in it or something like that, or a deluxe. What is it?
It's just a little Blues Junior. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
It's not that big. Yeah.
Turquoise?
It's got that California sort of sea green blue kind of. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. That's nice.
Yeah. Nice little.
Well, light. Let's have a look at it then. I'll meet you back here in a couple of minutes.
Okay. Good. Yeah. Great.
Cool.
And the chair even matches the amp. I think that's, you know, how'd you do that?
Yeah, cool. Right on.
Well, beautiful. And it's good that you still enjoy that. That's, you know, that's what it's about. It's why we do it, right?
Yeah.
You bet. Like, and there's nothing like being able to sit around with guitars like that. But that was my Kenny Rogers look, by the way. My kids said, "Dad, you look like Papa Smurf." And my wife said, "You know, Rick, happy wife, happy life. I think it's time to shave, you know."
Yeah, you got to know when to grow them, know when to shave them. I liked playing around. I had a beard once, you know, I did that thing. It was only I went outside. See, I think you took advantage of COVID. And, Gruden. I, my hair has been like this for the past 20, I don't even know how many years. And it was a year, more than a year, I didn't get my hair cut. And then I finally got brave enough to sneak out to one guy who is the guy who does it with the claws on his, that guy, if you've ever seen him.
Edward Scissorhands?
Pretty close, it's his brother. Okay. It's his brother.
They're shorter claws.
Yeah, they're short. It's man, it's the weirdest thing.
Yeah.
Valentino. And okay. I called up my bass player. I said, Larry, I really need a haircut. I don't want to go back to the other salon because there's too many people there. Where can I go? He said, go to Valentino. He'll see you privately. You make an appointment, blah, blah, blah. And so I think, all right, well, let me look. If he cuts Larry's hair, how bad could it be, right? And I look and I see the video of this guy that's got like finger picks on every finger, only they're blades. I swear, when you get it, just go look up, they're called the claws. So look up Valentino, C-L-A-W-C. Like the designer.
Okay.
Yeah, and the claws. And you'll see this, he's flipping your hair. I was surprised he didn't cut her ear off.
But he said he did it blindfolded on television.
Yeah, and I'm saying, I don't want that.
No, not blindfolded.
So yeah,
looks pretty good, Steve.
Yeah, it's not too bad. Even.
Yeah,
it's yeah, just,
yeah. I would be afraid I might lose an earlobe or something. So.
I know, but no.
Let me tell you what it was actually amazing. I mean, to be honest with you, the whole reason for me doing this show, out of being the chairman of the board, B-O-R-E-D, was to learn new things and I love new stuff. I love new music. I love new musicians. And when I originally started out doing the show, nobody wants to hear me play drums to, you know, songs. I mean, I could do that, but why? yeah. And if they want to hear that, there's plenty of it out there. So I thought one of my favorite things, and I'm going to think that it was the same for you being a Canadian band, one of my favorite things about touring, about being out there for months at a time, was running into people that you knew from 10 years ago in some club somewhere. And I love those. And this is one of those conversations. This is you and me. We're both playing the US Festival, and we're hanging out in catering, and this is the conversation. Hey, I heard you wrote a book. Yeah, and there we go. And yeah, so that was really, and you know, I wanted to do the comfortable background because, you know, gold records are not, you know, I like it out here in space. It's peaceful. There's, you
good.
Know.
Yeah, great. All
now,
right.
The book is available now for people to purchase.
Yeah, is it published, the book? Is it out?
Yeah, it should be in bookstores starting the 14th, but of course you can they can order it from Amazon anytime they want now and get it delivered. But ECW and I feel like we'd like to encourage people to go to their local bookstores and buy a hard copy. If you buy a hard copy, you can get the ebook anyways. I will say this though, if you buy the audio book, you get the two songs because I recorded those.
Those two songs?
Born to Pay, and there's another one called World of Song. So those two, and plus I played little jazz guitar things to kind of get from one section to another in the audio book. So there's like seven or eight of those that are kind of little treats that are part of the audio book. So it's not like I gave up my music in order to become a poet. I kind of went, all right, I'm going to make a transition here.
Of course not, man. I mean, I never thought that. I had been doing art forever. When I moved from New York down to Florida, whatever, 17 years ago, that's just started to happen. And then I decided to do the fashion line based on it. And, you know, everything has its season. Doesn't mean I don't play my drums every day. And to that point, did Angus tell you about Pass the Peas?
No.
Oh.
Go ahead. I did find out there's five questions that I had to think about.
Yeah, that's it. That's just that's just the fun part at the end.
Yeah, that's coming at the end, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, Pass the Peas is coming now. What Pass the Peas is I'm sitting here and I have I will show you. I can show you. I can do this. I have this.
Oh, yeah.
And so I'm thinking to myself, what can I do with this? my stuff is mic'd up. I mean, it doesn't get better. You know, I can move the mics microns to get the perfect sound. So what I did is I laid drum tracks, all kinds of drum tracks, Latin tracks, funk tracks, because I'm a, you know, I consider myself to be a pretty well-rounded player. And then I sent one to Booker King, bass player from New York, and he plays with everybody, and he slapped it right back at me. So then we sent it to Tony Bruno, who put guitar on it, and it, you know, these songs just keep going around. So if you're interested in getting some peas passed your way, mm-hmm. I'll send you.
Sure, why not?
Yeah, it's exactly, and you can, you know, it's just fun. It's just meant to be.
He passed the piece to Steve Stevens to put guitar on, yeah, it, and he finished the thing.
Yeah, he. I had you know, Billy Idol's guitar player, Steve Stevens.
Of course, yes.
We grew up. We, you know, we came up at the same time. We used to sneak him in to see our band when he was underage, 16. But I passed him the peas. He passed them back finished. He played everything. It was like, wow.
Just no vocals. Yeah.
No vocals. So, and you're welcome to.
Vocals.
Yeah, please. Vocals,
you
lyrics.
Have an amazing
voice.
You
know anybody that writes lyrics, maybe?
I did a project just recently for a company called Cleopatra Records, and they were doing a tribute album for Pink Floyd. And I got to sing Wish You Were Here. Joe Satriani played guitar. Carmen Appice played drums.
Oh, yeah. I know those guys.
Yeah, yeah. So that was kind of fun. But it was, again, one of these COVID projects, a kind of a pass the peas thing where, you know, I went into a studio with a friend of mine and he engineered and I did the vocals and we sent them back. And yeah, that's out in the marketplace now. And so I've been on an album with Joe Satriani and Carmen. I never get to meet them. I wasn't in the same room. But it was a pass the peace project.
Well, for this, we see the reason I wanted to do it this way, it's linear jamming. Because you, as a drummer, if you and I are in the room, right, you walk into the live room and I'm behind the drums and I start playing a shuffle, you're playing whatever, you know, if I break into, you know, 5/4 or I do whatever, you're going to follow me. So in that way, it's very much like a linear jam. There's nobody, you know, telling you what to play, what not to play, when, you know, it's just open. And then wherever you send it, the only thing that dictates what they play is what you and I played before it got there. So sure. It's very, you know, it's very responsive, I thought. Maybe.
Yeah, well, I think it's a great idea. I you know, I just saw an interview with a guy named Rick Beato, you know, has this amazing, great thing that's on the internet. And he's a great teacher. And he did an interview with Pat Metheny, who's one of my favorite musicians.
Yeah.
And so, in speaking of drummers, you know, Pat at one point he said, "Look, I tell this to, you know, musicians all the time and music students when I do workshops and things. Whoever is you know, controlling the money and booking the tour, that's obviously the band leader." He goes, "But when you get on stage, I tell everybody this. This is the truth of the matter. The drummer is always the leader. Once you're on stage, the drummer is the band leader and you must follow what the drummer lays down for you because that's how it works." And that was I saw that the same week that Charlie Watts passed away. And so there was a lot of talk about drummers, you know, floating around in the air. But I've always said that. It's like during sound checks, I would often say to my other musicians, "No, you got to get more hi-hat in your monitor because you got to be listening to where he's taking us." And so, you know, like guys turn the kick up. I go, "Yeah, yeah, the kick is good, but you got to have the hi-hat too. The hi-hat's the thing." And that was one of the things that was in that Count Me In show where the guy said, "Hi-hat, hi-hat." And he was doing a little, you know, the Iron Maiden guy was doing the tickety-tackety-tickety-tackety-tickety.
Yeah, Nico, yeah.
Yes, that is what I've always tried to tell people. That's the truth of it.
Well, Stuart Copeland, same thing. I mean, that guy has, you know, he's famous for his hi-hat work.
Yes. Yeah.
So, and everybody did a good job. I certainly don't mean to rag that if, you know.
No.
It's just I wanted to learn something, you know what I mean? And sure. If I see one more roadie take one more chrome drum stand out of a road case. That's you know, that's.
We watched the Paul.
Yeah, but I think your point is well taken. That it's Netflix, and so they're looking for a wider audience. They're my wife enjoyed it. You know, usually when I watch musician-oriented kinds of documentaries, she's going like, "This is you know." But can't we watch the next episode of, Bubba Voss and Game of Thrones, whatever. And I get it. And of course, for me, I've always sort of had that thing about music for its own purpose, music for its own reasons, as opposed to, hey, music so that I can sell a lot of records or music so that I can, sell a lot of tickets. It's like, no. Which is why, Pat Metheny's one of my favorites because he always only ever did it for the right reasons,
Well, yeah, I mean, that's, when I first heard about it and when I first got into it and first dictated that I would do this thing, I didn't know anything about tickets, girls, drugs, I didn't know anything about any of it. It was,
but apparently you've learned a lot about drugs.
Well, I like to study. I do study. I learned a little bit about money, too. I collect. I have the whole set. But please, we're going to segue. Right. Oh, no, sorry.
You need a little. Yeah. That's,
So, yeah, it's that's my world. The question. This is the other thing. On Friday nights, we do this thing called Free for All Friday. And okay. The same Zoom key that you use to get into this. You can come into that at the same time, 7 to... You're in Canada still now?
I am.
Ontario, yeah. Different time zone or... No, Eastern?
Well, where are you down in Florida?
I'm in Eastern. I'm in Fort Myers.
Yeah.
On the west
coast. That's the same as... I'm in Toronto, so,
Okay, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, same time zone. Yep.
All right. Yeah. So, seven...
On Friday, the Triumph documentary is being launched at the Toronto International Film Festival. So...
Wow.
I'm not around at 7 o'clock. I'm going to be doing the schmooze and, dressed in a jacket and trying to look nice for the red carpet. And yeah, because that's finally... It took 2 years... for Banger Films to get that one to the public, but it's finally going to happen. And
I'll tell you something interesting. Is it using the US Festival footage?
It uses little bits of all kinds of stuff. For sure it uses some of that. Yeah. Like that footage that you see, like we were the only people that took advantage of all of this footage that sat in a warehouse in California after the event. And we went to,
Steve Wozniak.
And we went, Wozniak, can we can we access the footage? He said, oh yeah, sure, take whatever you want. And we were the only people that did. Of course, it was 1983. Nobody had really gotten to this idea yet of,
right, it hadn't blossomed yet.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, I made a documentary film on the life of John Entwistle, which I actually we started making when he was alive. That's just, for fun, and then long story short. But I, with the guy that I co-produced it with, said, I'm coming to Florida. I'm going over across to Fort Lauderdale. A guy has a storage locker or whatever, giant, with all the US Festival tapes. The Police, he's got, and the stuff we watched that day, I was like, and it's all on those, the big,
Yep.
And I said, you're going to buy this? To the guy I was with, he said, well, if he's selling it, I'm going to buy it. I said, you'll never clear this stuff. I don't know, but I saw a lot of that. It was incredible.
It really was. And it was just sitting around. Nobody was doing anything with it. Now, part of that, too, was that some of the people go, yeah, we didn't have the greatest night. We'd been smoking a little of the stuff back in the car.
Uh-huh. Yeah, from the drum guys.
Yeah. Okay, man. Get to the questions. Come on.
Okay, here they come. You ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
You're on tour. Here and there, up and down. Favorite place when you're going to this spot on the globe, you can't wait to eat at... Favorite restaurant on the road.
Okay. I'm gonna morph your question a little bit, because a lot of times when I would be on the road, the food was going to be brought to the dressing room, you know, between sound check and gig. So what places had the best, you know, backstage catering? And I, in the last stages of my career, I was doing a lot of duo shows. I was out playing with another guitar player, Dave Dunlop. And Dave was much more of a foodie than I was. But we would play these places. They were called city wineries. And they had very good menus. And they would let you sort of pick whatever you wanted off the menu. So the food there was good. But and there was another place we played. I'm going to mention this one just to give them a plug. And it was called, the Infinity Music Hall in Norfolk. And they had a really great menu, and it was a great gig to play. It was a really nice venue. But the best was the Cleveland Music Box Supper Club. And their menu was the best food, and they were the nicest people. And that was the gourmet experience. So if anybody's ever in Cleveland, you got to go to the Music Box Supper Club, because the food there is very, very good. Never mind.
So we're going to put that down as your answer.
Yeah.
Okay. No, but wait. Okay, that's fine. But now I have a story I'm going to tell you, which is a great rock and roll story. And I know that's why I'm on this show, because that's what you know, it's like rock and roll storytellers in outer space. Okay. So we'd signed with Universal around 1984, 85. They were MCA at the time, but they turned into Universal, the record company that owned the world. And Irving Azoff was the president. And we were getting treated really, really nice. And so when we were in Chicago, the local guy said, we got to go to Maxim's. Now, I don't know if you know about Maxim's, but it's in the basement of the something towers. Wait, I wrote it down just so that I wouldn't forget. The Astor Towers.
Astor Towers, yeah.
Yeah, which is as high end gets, okay? We weren't staying there, but the rep took us there. And I had swordfish, and it was, you know, one of the most amazing meals I'd ever had, and it's an amazing restaurant. But the reason I'm raising this is because Maxim's is the place where Joe Walsh one night decided to go with John Belushi. And there's many, many stories, you know, that have circulated over the years about this, but they won't let you in unless you got a jacket and a tie and you can't wear jeans. And these two rock and roll freaks show up in their jeans and they want in, and they go, no, sorry, I'm sorry, sir, you can't come in. And so they apparently spray painted their pants.
Yes,
they
went out. I heard that.
Yeah, spray painted their pants so they could get back in. And that was just the beginning of the destruction, because eventually they ended up in the hotel in the room, you know, AstroTest, and they trashed the room in spectacular fashion. A grand piano might have been pushed off a balcony. I can't say that one for sure, but Irving said that it was the worst destruction that Joe had ever done. But of course, in Irving's mind and in Joe's mind, the worst would be the best.
Yes.
Well, right. The stuff of legends. You know, that's.
I got accountants to pay for it all.
Yeah.
You know, I know more than a little bit about Joe. I spent a week with him one night.
And Keith Moon, there would have been some.
Right. Yeah. Well, yeah. Well, all right. Here, we'll just do this a little behind the scenes stuff that you might not know. When Joe was Crazy Joe, he was going out with a girl who, for all intents and purposes, was Crazy Lisa. And when Joe decided to straighten out, he decided that he could not be with Crazy Lisa anymore. So Entwistle got her.
Oh, yeah. She lived with him for 10 years.
While you were working with him?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
You're going to have to read that book.
Yes.
You want to read a book, read that one.
Yeah. Okay.
That's, yeah.
Wow. And,
oh, man. I mean, let me tell you what. If there weren't a million people watching, I could tell you stories that would.
But she's dead now,
yeah,
too.
She's
you can't
dead
get clearance now. For those, Steve.
Well, yeah. There's a book. It's
you
all
have
right.
to be careful. You'd have to give them a pseudonym. Write a poem.
I you don't want to know what. That's. I'm going to move on with the questionnaire now, Rick. And very interesting. I don't know how many of the fans out there. There's so many things that in our careers, yours and mine, that parallel each other. Your first album comes out. They misspell your first name, and you decide to keep that spelling. right?
Yep.
Do you know Leslie West? You know Leslie, right?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay.
I knew Leslie, yes.
Leslie, yeah, R.I.P. Leslie calls me up and he says, Steve, I want you to play on my album. I said, when? In an hour. So I go and I do the album with him. And the album comes out and my name is misspelled. He's got the U behind the O. So it's Loungo. And he's telling me, just change it. It'd be better anyway. Change. So you guys, you should just change. I told Corky Lang the same thing. I said, Corky, no one's going to spell this ridiculous thing. Change it.
Your Leslie impression is quite good.
Oh, I got
I played a thing, the NAMM show, and Leslie was part of the, you know, Dean Guitars thing that I had been a part of. And he had my contact information. And then one day out of the blue, like 6 months after that, I get a phone call and it's his voice. He goes, hey, Rick. I go, hey. And he goes, it's Leslie. I go, yeah, how are you doing? He goes, listen, I've cracked a wisdom tooth. I go, Leslie, this is Rick Emmett, the guitar player. He goes, oh, fuck, I thought you were Rick, my dentist. So he picked the wrong Rick from his call list.
That's for Eddie Money did the same thing.
Oh, yeah?
Eddie.
Well, it was
to
Steve
Long. Eddie, I don't know if you know Access TV, it's the rock channel.
Yeah.
Eddie had two seasons of a show on there. And out of nowhere, he calls me up and he says, Stevie Longo, is this the incredible drummer or the gay producer?
Oprah's great
producer. Yeah. And I said, Stevie, it's like... Is this the incredible drummer or Oprah's gay producer? And I said, well, I really hope it's the incredible drummer because I don't know Oprah.
Oh, man.
And it turns out that the guy that produced his show for Access was also Steve Longo. Yeah. But, you know, we're...
Gay producer.
Yeah. So, I love playing
Steve
with Eddie.
Not Steve Loungo.
No. No, see, I don't do the lounge thing. So why would I call myself that?
Yeah, of course. No, just not. And, all right. Question number two. Come on, let's go.
Okay, number two. Here it comes. Oh, I don't want to go into OT in Canada. All right. Set list comes out. Oh, man. Favorite song to play live.
I always used it to close my show solo, Suitcase Blues from the Just a Game album. It was it should have never been on a rock record because it was a jazz tune. But it was always my favorite. But there's two other favorites I'm going to mention. One of them was I used to love to play in Triumph when we'd get to fight the good fight. It was always the encore song. And it was the end of the night. So I loved that song because you could give it everything you had because you didn't have to save anything anymore. The set was going to be over. So I loved that feeling. And, of course, the crowd, you know, the encore tune. And plus it was like, you know, the raise your fist. You know, the idea behind the song was like a banner, you know. So I love that one, was the unfurling of the flag. And then the one that I loved to play when I was in duos with Dave Dunlop, always had it on the set list, was an instrumental called Three Clouds, just because we could both blow our brains out and kick each other's ass. It was great.
That's cool. Okay, good one.
Yeah.
Okay, so now this next one, Set List, comes out. I'm not so happy to see this song. I don't ever want to play this song again. What's that song?
That song's called State of Grace. And the reason I could never do it anymore was because we played it at my brother's funeral. And once that had happened, I went, I'm never going to be able to sing this and get through it. Like, I'm never going to be able to find that place inside myself where I can bring it, where I can deliver it. Like, so I retired the song from the set list, and I'll never play it again.
Okay, that's a good answer.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So guitar, maybe a little drums, this and that. If you could absolutely shred at another instrument other than your own, and that includes vocals, what would it be?
I would be a piano player, no question about it.
Okay.
Because to me, the piano is the best of all instruments. Because there's 88 notes laid out there, And you can be an orchestra if you know what you're doing. You can, like, this is a little known fact about Matheny, but Pat can play keyboards very, very good, and that's what he composes on. Lyle Mays, who was his, you know, second in command in the Pat Matheny group, Lyle can play guitar really, really well. So what a marriage made in heaven that you got a keyboard player that can play guitar and a guitar player that can play keyboard, and they can sit down with an Oberheim, both of them, and go, yeah, how about this? Well, what about this voicing, Pat? And he's going, yeah, that sits nice on the guitar, yeah. Like, that would have been, keyboard would have been my thing. But when I was in music college, I almost flunked an introductory keyboard. Like, I'm so left-handed. I play guitar right-hand, but I'm so left-handed that I couldn't get both hands going at the same time on a piano keyboard. I just couldn't do it.
So you play guitar right-hand? I mean, I saw that. I would have noticed because I'm, you know, wow. But yeah. You're left-handed in life?
Yeah. I do things of strength with my left hand. Like, if I was going to throw a baseball, I'd throw with my left hand. If I was going to hammer a nail, I'd hammer with my left. But when I write my name, I write with my right. When I pick up a fork, I eat with my right. So it's called dextrosinistral. It's not ambidextrous.
Right.
I'm left hand strong, right hand fine control. And in fact, I'm going to show you something here. When you see guitar players and they pick like this, like their right hand is kind of like this.
Right.
Eric Johnson, for example, he's a right-handed guy. When you see a guy like this, like me, Eddie Van Halen, Steve Morse, probably left hand strong on the fretboard, gives you a big advantage here, disadvantage here, but you turn your hand and you kind of pick like this, you know.
And what is that called? Like, it's not ambidextrous, it's what?
Dextrosinistral.
Dextrosinistral.
Dextro, yeah, like dextrose is
dextro,
is,
right.
Is right, and sinistra is left. So if you're the other way around, if you did things of strength with your right hand and fine motor control with your left, you'd be sinistrodextral.
Oh, okay. So it's left, right, right, left. Because yeah. I, as a drummer, I play right-handed, but when I play double bass, I play it the way a lefty would play it.
Yeah.
That in that direction. As
so you get some. I think it's wiring between the hemispheres of the brain. That's my theory. I'm pretty sure it's probably right, because there's been people that have had brain damage and then they lose the ability on the other side of their, you know. So I think it's the way your brain's wired, but.
And I can do it the other way around, but I don't want to. And I know you know what I mean.
Yeah. Can you play some keyboards at all?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Which
I grew
hand
up
is
with
better? Are you right-handed?
My right hand is better.
Yeah,
right. No, I'm absolutely righty in the world.
Yeah.
But there are certain things that my left hand does that my right hand can't do. And like I said, when I'm playing, I'm like lefty footed or whatever that
yeah,
means.
Yeah.
So anyway, all right. So moving right along. So piano, good one.
Yeah.
Good one. This is the coup de grace.
Yep. Yeah.
If you could play one show with anybody, living or dead, who would it be?
I would want to go back between 1987 and 1995 so that I could sit in with the Pat Metheny group during that period.
Wow. That's post-Jocko, right?
Oh, yeah. Way, way past. You know, it might even have been past Steve Rodby touring with the band. But Lyle was still in it. And there was a Canadian guy singing with him named David Blaymeyers. And those have sort of always been kind of my favorite albums. There was Still Life Talking is where it started, that era of the group. And it sort of ended with an album called We Live Here, which was a real departure for them. They did shit to drum loops and you know, they were writing songs based on, well, this is, I loved Earth, Wind, and Fire when I was a kid, so I'm going to have a tune that's kind of Earth, Wind, and Fiery. Or, we really loved the Miles Davis kind of blues stuff, so we're going to have a tune that's kind of based on that vibe. So I always loved that record because it was like musicians going, you know, I live here. Here's the roadmap of you know, of who I am and how I got here. So that music to me was always something just extra special. You know, and I know, like, as a musician, you probably have a deep respect for, like, say, the Steely Dan Asia album, right? Like, there's albums like that.
Sure.
There's, and everybody's got them. But there's a couple of those Pat Metheny ones through that time period where I would have given anything to sit in with that band. I wouldn't have had to play the whole set because I wouldn't have been able to cut it, but just a couple of them that I could handle.
Yeah. Well, listen, this is your dream here, so you would be able to cut it.
Yeah.
and because it's your dream, you could even play piano on some songs. There is nothing outside of, I'm telling you, I'm out here. I feel like anything's possible.
All right.
Rick, you've been great, man. Yeah. Thank you so much. I'm gonna pass you some peas. You're welcome any Friday.
Have a great time Friday night.
Yeah, and congratulations on your documentary. Let's catch up about that. And man, all good things. And again, let me push the book. Well, you know what? I'll let you go, and I'll push the book, and we'll post the link.
All right. Have fun in the capsule with the dog. I hope you're going to have
a
bad
It's great. Friends. Believe me, it's good out here. Have fun. I'll talk soon. Guys.
See you. Take care.
Take care. All right. And boom.
Wow. Great.
How cool was that?
Yeah.
And very interesting. And I didn't get to ask him half the stuff I would have asked him.
Well,
because I was wondering if there was a club scene, like, you know, he's my age, maybe a year younger. And I was wondering, you know, and so they made it in that, you know, in that sweet spot time. I was going to ask him if there was like a Canadian club scene that they toured in or anything like that.
The show went over by 24 minutes and that flew by.
Man, it surely did. Well, listen, I know some of you kids have to get to bed, and I'm sorry if I kept you up. Rick Emmett, oh, please. Yeah, wait.
Yeah, wait. Rick's book.
Yeah, I got
to get it. There's right really here. Some really
yeah, it's
deep
awesome.
Poems. Yeah, and you can order it on Amazon.
So we'll post the links. It's, you know, and
if
it's,
you want the two songs, get the audio book.
Or get the whole thing.
Yeah.
Because
it'll
you can.
It'll make a great gift.
Ooh, that is a
it
great
would
gift.
Be a great gift. Okay, there tomorrow night we have Howard Helm.
Oh, Howard Helm, yes.
Keyboard player for Refuge, Ian Hunter, Mick Ronson, and he's also a composer.
That's great. So see, maybe we'll get Howard in on the peas with Rick. Because I'm getting a real jazz vibe from him, man. I'm thinking that I got to go there instead of doing pound, you know.
I know.
You know.
Okay.
All right. As always, if I don't see you in the future, I'll see you in the pasture.
Good night, everybody.
Whoa. Ho-ho! I'm outside. I feel like Richard Branson.